Seven Dials presents And It Was Beautiful, Marcelo Bielsa and the Rebirth of Leeds United by Phil Hay. Read by Phil Hay and Ralph Ineson. Foreword by Victor Orta. In the summer of 1986, while my mother and father were busy with work, I spent most of the holidays with my two brothers. They were older than me, 9 or 10 years older. And you know how it is when you're 16 or 17 and your little kid brother is always with you. He's annoying, no? In Spain, we have a famous card game called Moose, and I would go with them when they went to play it with friends. I annoyed them by ruining the game, by doing the wrong things with the cards. We were at this kiosk, and the guy who owned it, he saw what was happening, and he gave me a box with maybe 100 packets of football cards in it. I was 7 years old, and it was the first time I thought about football. The cards were the faces of the players at World Cup 86. I looked through them all and started to do a bit of a challenge with my brothers. They would pull a card out, say the name on it, and I would try to tell them which nation they played for and which club. So, Enzo Francescoli, Uruguay and River Plate. Cha Boom Kun, South Korea, Bayer Leverkusen. Alemão, Brazil, who would go on and play at Napoli. I would do this with their friends too. I was good at it. You choose a card, and I'll tell you this, this, and this. It earned me acceptance from older people, and every kid likes that. I thought then that football could be my passion, something to love. Am I a football romantic? Absolutely. The day I wake up and don't feel passion for football, I'll go home and do something else, like chemistry or something different. I'm still like the young Victor Orta, who went to the hotels in Madrid where teams were staying to get their autographs. Lots of us did that when a big team from Europe arrived. It was normal. But sometimes, with smaller teams, I would be the only one there. One day, Racing Santander arrived to play Atletico Madrid. At the hotel, it was just me. Some of the Racing Santander players recognised me, because they'd seen me before, and said, "Victor, you are always here. Every time we come, we see you. Why?" Because I had an album with a photograph of different footballers with a space for their autograph underneath. I had to fill them all in, so I would wait for hours if I had to. It made my day. Sometimes it made my week. A total passion for football is what many people see in Marcelo Bielsa. I see it too. When I first started to learn about Marcelo, he was a reference for a lot of things that were developing in football. Technical secretaries and scouting departments were not things people spoke about when he was doing those types of jobs at Newell's Old Boys. It seemed like he was the first with things. I know Bielsa didn't have a big career as a player, yet he was one of the biggest coaches in the world. He gave me a feeling about the level you could arrive from, the feeling that you could come from nothing. I had a friend, Pablo, who always sent me newspapers from Argentina. He told me once about how before Argentina played a friendly against Holland, Bielsa wanted information from the last 20 games Holland had played. I didn't know why, but who knows, maybe there was some information he could get from that. More and more, I started to think about the game in that way. Then came the meeting at Sevilla. They tried to appoint Marcelo as head coach in 2011. I was working for the club, but I wasn't in the meeting. The chairman, Jose Maria del Nido, and director of football, Monchi, were in there, and they've spoken about it before. What happened is not a secret. I prepared a report of perhaps 120 pages with all the information I could give them. The chairman was able to say to Marcelo, "This is what I know about you." Marcelo had prepared a report on Sevilla of 1,000 pages, 1,000 pages long, and this is what I know about you. The chairman and Monchi talked about him afterwards in this amazing way, like, wow. He impressed them both, really, really impressed them. I was in football professionally by then, but the period that first made me fascinated about Bielsa was the World Cup in 2002. All the games were free on TV in Spain, so I watched the whole of the qualifying stage. Argentina were top of their group and had something like a 15-point difference over Brazil. They were incredible. Brazil won the World Cup, but for me, I felt it with Argentina. I watched the Olympic Games as a pundit when Argentina won the gold medal in 2004. In one game, they beat Serbia and Montenegro 6-0. What energy. More and more, the thought in my head was, imagine the level of work of this man in charge, even when you get knocked out of the group stages of a World Cup. My opinion was that Marcelo could jump into Europe as a club manager. His football would work here, I thought. But if you ask me why I believed he would be perfect for Leeds United 3 years ago, My view is that the English environment is really coachable. When you're a coach in England, the players come to you and you can say, jump off this bridge. They will jump, and when they're in the cold water, they will ask you why you wanted them to jump. My feeling about Latin football is that you say, jump off a bridge, and the players stop and ask why first. They don't just jump into the water. Whatever Marcelo asked for, I knew the players here would try. They would have the trust in this incredible coach. The summer when he came to Leeds was after the first year of Andrea Rodriziani's project here. The project was not bad, in my opinion, but that year taught us something. I said to Andrea that Leeds United did not have the capacity to support a medium-term project because the historic pressure for promotion can't be appeased. We can't be a medium-term project in the Championship. Other teams can be, but not us. So either we change the club we are at, or we change the project. At that time, I had an offer to go to a different job in Spain. I had dinner with Andrea, where we had lots of conversation and lots of arguments, but arguments in a good way. I thought that to reduce the gap in the league, we needed to make a really good investment in a top-class coach, maybe one who is outside the budget. It was the day after when we were in a car, and we had that famous conversation, where Andrea asked me to tell him my favourite. The report I made in Sevilla about Marcelo was still on my hard disk, so I updated it and presented it to Andrea and our chief executive, Angus Kinnear. This is who I'm talking about, I said. This is why he could be so amazing. The Championship was difficult to offer to Marcelo. I thought Leeds was a good environment for him, but my feeling was that he would say no, that he would have something better to consider. That, to me, is why I think he made the challenge for us, to meet him in Buenos Aires. If we were brave enough to travel to Buenos Aires to meet him, we were serious. We had to prove that we were. I was excited on the flight down there, but there was one crazy moment. When I landed, I called Marcelo, and I didn't get an answer. We had spoken the day before, and I was worried that I had said something wrong, something to upset him. The chairman had travelled from Europe for this, so I was nervous. At the hotel, I asked the guy at reception which meeting room we had hired. I remember the name perfectly, Salon Telos. I opened the door expecting, well, I don't know what. Honestly, it was like NASA. There were about five computers spread about. There was a big board with all the names of our players. Marcelo was there, ready to start. My first thought was, help us. After a second meeting with Angus and me, I thought it was done. I thought Marcelo would be our head coach. But I knew some people in football would say to Andrea, you are crazy, crazy, crazy. When we landed, I talked to him and told him we had to be brave and have passion. Give me this responsibility and I will assume all of it, in a good way and a bad. But if it fails, fire me. Fire me and get a new director of football. Put me out as if that was my last chance. But until then, be brave. Andrea will tell you he had at least 20 messages saying, what are you doing? But before we fail, have passion first. Angus helped me a lot in these discussions. You don't need me to tell you what a success Marcelo became at Leeds. I'll let that speak for itself. But what we did was change the strategy at the right time. The thing that made me proudest of all about Leeds was the way everyone at the club felt involved and relevant as we tried to win promotion. From Mandy in ticket sales to Patrick Bamford scoring the goals, everyone had the same sense of what we were doing. Everyone made a difference. I have a friend, Alberto Garcia, a goalkeeper at Rayo Vallecano, who has won four promotions in his career. I'll never forget something he said to me once. The management and the office help win promotion, not just the players. Get it right everywhere in a club, and it will work. For sure, we got it right with Marcelo. Victor Orta, Leeds United Director of Football.
Introduction. Walking in the rain. I tell the same story whenever anyone asks about Marcelo Bielsa's idiosyncrasies. And because his reputation goes before him, people usually do. Is it fair to portray Bielsa as eccentric? And if it is fair, what form do those eccentricities take? In 2019, I was working as the Yorkshire Evening Post's chief football writer and up at Leeds United's training ground for Bielsa's regular Thursday press conference. With very rare exceptions, he was bang on time for his chats with the media, and there were days when he would leave Thorpe Arch as soon as the briefing finished. On this particular Thursday, the rain was hammering down. Good Scottish weather, as someone once said. I drove down the driveway leading out to the main road, and there was Bielsa, already soaked, and walking alone in nothing more than a club tracksuit. He always wore a club tracksuit. I pulled up and wound down the car window. "Marcelo, can I give you a lift?" My route home went fairly close to his flat in Weatherby, a 45-minute walk away. No, thank you," he said. "I like this." It was not a secret that Bielsa liked to walk. "You sure?" I asked. A nod, a smile, and then he was off, along the pavement up Walton Road and out of sight. Bielsa was 65, and if it had been my father, I would have told him to grow up and get in the front seat. The mid-May temperature felt bearable, but the rain was relentless, and the thought popped into my head that if anything happened to Bielsa between here and Weatherby, the police would record that the last person to speak to him was that Scottish reporter from the YEP, and why on earth did he not insist on driving him home? But then you found yourself laughing, because Bielsa's odd tendencies were endearing. The exercise did him good and gave him time to think. Every now and again, he would talk quite seriously about buying a bike and cycling to work, a multi-million pound asset pedalling along country lanes where lorries and Range Rovers travelled at breakneck speeds. We were lucky in Leeds that as journalists, we were able to piece together a proper picture of Bielsa. Or as clear a picture as you can get of someone who closely guards what privacy he has. At other clubs like Leo, his tenure came crashing down long before any rapport was established with the media or the public. And the day before I started writing this introduction, he was on a video link to a court in France, arguing over compensation he claimed he was owed by Leo, some £50 million plus. Even at Athletic Bilbao and Marseille, two clubs who felt lasting affection for him, he burned brightly and then he was gone, in a way which generated feelings of regret. But at Leeds, something clicked. In giving Bielsa the right amount of support and deference, Leeds hit the sweet spot with him. To begin with, the club were wary of presuming that Bielsa's first season as head coach would result in a second. By the time this book went to print, they were preparing to discuss a fourth year in charge. To the uninitiated, and most of us who wrote about Leeds were uninitiated on the subject of Bielsa at first, it was easy to form an image of Bielsa as an incendiary device. Newspaper profiles of him were peppered with details of run-ins and sudden resignations, like the time he accepted the manager's job at Lazio and then quit without boarding his scheduled flight from Buenos Aires to Rome. You read about the brilliance of his football in Bilbao, but even that story ended with him reporting himself to the police after a scuffle with a contractor who was working on Athletic's training ground. Leeds had experienced their share of unsuitable managers, and most of them had done nothing more than drain the club's diminished pool of hope a little more. When it became clear that Leeds were trying to appoint Bielsa, I spoke to a writer in Argentina about him. "This could be amazing," he said, "or it could be over very soon." For Leeds, it was a big and expensive roll of the dice. As you educated yourself about his quirks, you naturally questioned if any part of his persona was an act, or if not an act, were the years of Bielsa being off the wall in comparison to the average coach had accentuated those quirks and led him, perhaps subconsciously, to act up in the way he was expected to. But then you heard the tales of Bielsa moving out of a five-star hotel near Harrogate and asking the logistics staff at Leeds to make inquiries about a bedsit above a newsagent's in Boston Spa. You found him settling eventually in Weatherby, in a nondescript flat which would not make you look twice as you walked past it. The ferocity of his training sessions was not for show, less still for the benefit of anyone peering in. Everything was mapped out, everything was methodical, and in so many ways, everything was logical. A French documentary team asked me after Leeds were promoted in 2020 whether Bielsa should be classed as crazy or not. They asked everyone who appeared on the programme the same question. In a footballing sense, not crazy, not loco in the slightest. Being Bielsa looks exhausting. Pretending to be Bielsa would probably kill you. The more you see of him, and the more you listen to him, the more you learn that a personality like his cannot be manufactured. Slowly you came to understand about some of what was in his head and how intently he fixated on the game. one of his earliest press conferences at Leeds, elicited a random apology to Hernan Crespo over a perceived slight which occurred more than 15 years earlier, while Bielsa was coaching Argentina. It stemmed from a question about why Bielsa had only one style and one tactical approach. Why was there no plan B up his sleeve? Because, he said, a footballer has to believe that his coach has faith in his own plan. If you chop and change, you transmit a lack of personal confidence, which inevitably infects the players. And then came an 8-minute monologue in which Bielsa explained that he had wronged Crespo by telling him at a young age that he was a player of maturity, a trick designed to nurture the forward's self-assurance. Bielsa was caught in a lie several years later when he forgot that conversation and claimed that an older Crespo had benefited from growing up. Crespo took offence, and Bielsa regretted it enough to be talking about the slight almost 2 decades later. "This is the kind of thing I cannot forgive myself for," he said. The next morning, Crespo responded on Twitter and buried the hatchet by accepting Bielsa's apology. To us, it felt like something of nothing, but it had evidently been eating away at Bielsa. Covering a club in England's second division, you had the sense of existing in a strange reality as the two famous Argentinian faces made up via the internet. Bielsa had his own code when dealing with the press: softly spoken, polite, and patient, but unwilling to engage personally. On occasions, he would walk past you after a game and, without looking at you, pat you on the shoulder and then walk on silently, his form of courtesy. His refusal to speak English in public was a bone of contention with some, but if you wanted to dig into Bielsa's brain and to grasp his inner thoughts, or to gauge how he actually felt, he had to speak in Spanish. It gave you detail and nuance, even after his comments had passed through a translator. It allowed Bielsa to express himself properly. Covering Bielsa was a wasted opportunity if you got bogged down in standard football chat. Routine questions were dealt with in a few short sentences. The philosophical discussions could go on forever. And that was where the gold was found. Football teaches you that every coach is different and every regime is different. No manager at Leeds has ever attacked the job in quite the same way as any other. But very few were as transformational as Bielsa. Very few were able to redraw everything at Elland Road in the way that Bielsa did. The speed of the change after his appointment was extraordinary, right from his first game at home to Stoke City. Leeds swarmed all over Stoke, oozing flair and intensity unlike anything Elland Road was used to. Bielsa was still and passive for much of the game, impervious to the crackle around him. Many supporters will say that they felt something stirring on that hot August afternoon. That is easy to say now with hindsight, but it is also true. The sensation of a style which seemed too good to fail. An hour or so after full time, I walked through the empty stands and bumped into a steward, Alan, whom I had got to know after starting at the Evening Post. I looked at him and we laughed. "Jesus," he said, "close enough." In a matter of weeks, Bielsa brought sanity to the madhouse. For years, this had been a club where careers came to die. You had to be relatively close to Leeds to fully understand how the club and their inherent ability to implode dragged down managers and players and crushed expectancy. Underachievement was endemic. Bielsa was not without his faults, and in no way was he low maintenance, but for Leeds, at that juncture, he was the optimum choice. And Leeds were perfect for him. If and when promotion came, we all wondered how he would react. Now in his 60s, he was no longer the wild-haired man who rode on the shoulders of supporters and swung a shirt around his head after winning his first trophy at Newell's Old Boys in the 1990s. He was older and more restrained, more inclined to take the blame when it went wrong than take the credit when it came good. But the achievement would be incomplete unless Bielsa felt it like the city around him. The final minutes of Take Us Home, Leeds United, the Amazon series covering his reign, drew the emotion from him beautifully. They captured the night in 2020, when his players lifted the championship trophy. And as Bielsa spoke tenderly, a camera drifted over Elland Road and focused on the crowd in the streets below, flares, flags and all. The images are as poignant as they are euphoric, a night frozen in time, and one which neither Leeds nor Bielsa will ever experience in the same way again. If there is something that makes this profession attractive to me, it's the power to be in contact with the passion of the public, Bielsa says. The supporters, the only thing for them is that they love their club. The only thing they receive in exchange is emotion. This is going to be a lovely moment for all of my life. And it was beautiful. Due to medical reasons, I'm passing the narration of the rest of this audiobook to another member of the team who'll take you through the rest of the season. Enjoy!
Chapter 1, September. Leeds United had pushed all week for Marcelo Bielsa to sign the papers. Meetings at Elland Road, meetings at their training ground, and repeated discussions about the details of his contract. The club expected the process of renewing his deal to be slow. Negotiations with Bielsa generally were. But it is Thursday night, and on Saturday evening, they're due to start the new Premier League season away at Liverpool. Bielsa will be at Anfield regardless, committed to managing Leeds whether his new contract is finalised or not. But from a PR perspective, the club's hierarchy know how this looks. The coach who brought them promotion after 16 lean years in the EFL, stalling on their offer of an extension. On the outside, questions are being asked. It is not that Bielsa is undecided about his future. At the start of pre-season, he and Leeds agreed in principle that he would stay on for a third year as head coach. The relationship is robust, and before the club lifted the championship title in July 2020, Bielsa surprised Leeds by inquiring about the average wage of a manager in that league. A gentle indication that he might consider taking a cut in salary to remain in charge if promotion went begging again. His contract, a huge stack of documents which one official at Elland Road describes as war and peace, is broadly in place, and Leeds have no fear of losing him. It was different 12 months earlier, at the end of Bielsa's first season in the job. The risk of him deciding that 1 year in England was enough for him prompted Leeds to draw up a shortlist of potential replacements. They were ready to reach out to Slavisa Jokanovic and Aitor Karanka, both of whom had won promotion from the championship before. Bielsa came close to doing the same at the first attempt in 2019, but hit the wall during Leeds' chaotic defeat to Derby County in the playoff semi-finals. A season of promise went up in smoke on one hot, brutal evening at Elland Road. Bielsa's wife, Laura, had flown in from Argentina and was there with him at his lowest ebb. After full time, he went round a despondent dressing room and, without saying much, patted his players on the shoulder before picking up his bags and disappearing. For 24 hours, it felt as if the project was blown. Bielsa believed Leeds would replace him as a result of his failure to win promotion, and he did not intend to argue if they chose to let him go. A sombre mood settled on the training ground as his staff began removing equipment and files. His squad met for a drink before heading off for the summer, all of them in the dark about what would come next. Bielsa had left a message on Calvin Phillips's mobile, asking to meet, but for reasons Phillips never discovered, did not follow up the call. It was only when Leeds got in touch and told Bielsa that they wanted to exercise an option to extend his deal for another 12 months that the doubt was removed. The invitation to stay was all Bielsa needed. After witnessing the extent of his impact at Elland Road, Leeds were bemused by the suggestion that their confidence in him might have diminished. Talks ensued with Director of Football Victor Orta and Chief Executive Angus Kinnear, and the extension was activated within a fortnight. This time, there is no alternative shortlist in play. Bielsa has given a verbal commitment, but his latest deal requires non-stop translation from English to Spanish, and he fixates on the minutiae in it. These details matter to him as much as the core elements like his salary and bonus structure. As someone once said to me, Pablo Hernandez out for 6 months, or work in the training ground car park delayed for a week. In his mind, they're equally big problems. He doesn't differentiate between them. Bielsa holds off on providing his signature until everything is just so and set down in print. The contract itself is unusually complex, containing clauses that most managerial deals do not. His coaching staff are subject to non-disclosure agreements, limiting what they can say in public about Bielsa. He wants Leeds to tighten the terms of the NDAs. The wage packet paid to him covers not only his salary, but those of his backroom team too, and promotion results in pay rises across the board. The entire pot of cash goes to him, and he distributes it as he sees fit, paying his assistants directly, and by all accounts paying them well. Normally a club of Leeds' size would not agree to an arrangement like that. It runs the risk of financial disputes further down the line. But Bielsa operated like this with other European teams, and his system of remuneration is non-negotiable. Leeds are happy to oblige, but when it comes to contract renewals, they're not just negotiating with Bielsa. They're negotiating by proxy with the team around him, the iron circle of coaches and analysts who devote themselves to his work. Among the questions Bielsa has, and one of the things he tries to establish, is how his media commitments will change in the Premier League. For years, he has kept journalists at arm's length by establishing firm boundaries with them. He sits willingly in press conferences for as long as anyone wants him to, or for as long as the questions demand. But aside from those, he is almost inaccessible. In Argentina, they say he was once stung by a bad experience in a one-on-one interview and resolved never to expose himself in that way again. Bielsa's own explanation is that no reporter deserves more time with him than any other, and no reporter should have the luxury of exclusive quotes. As he said to Pep Guardiola when they met for the first time in 2006, "Why am I going to give an interview to a powerful guy and deny it to a small reporter from the provinces? What is my reason for doing such a thing?" When Leeds first appointed Bielsa, he tried to avoid the live pre- and post-match interviews Sky Sports carried out as part of its broadcast contracts with the EFL. The threat of sanctions from the EFL persuaded him to play ball, but only reluctantly. In the Premier League, the media requirements will soar. Bielsa wants to know how much he will be asked to do and what punishments he will face if he declines to fulfil his duties. In the past, the Premier League has fined other managers like Guardiola for skipping interviews. At Anfield, on day one of the 2020-21 season, Bielsa is expected to speak to 7 different outlets after full time. They are lined up along the side of the pitch, waiting for him to step in front of the microphone. Bielsa draws the line at 3, and it is not only the external media who are treading on eggshells. Owing to confusion and the summer departure of his assistant and translator, Diego Flores, Bielsa's column in Leeds' matchday programme disappears. It returns suddenly 2 months later, after Bielsa asks why the club are no longer printing it. On the Friday morning before Liverpool, as his players train for the last time and prepare to take the team bus to Merseyside, Leeds confirm that Bielsa's contract has been signed, another 12-month extension to the end of the season. The worst-kept secret in Leeds, jokes the club's head of communications as he sends the press release through. In a sense, it makes no difference to the weekend ahead. Bielsa's previous contract was a rolling deal, and the Premier League has already given approval for him to take to the touchline at Anfield, either way. But negotiations between him and Leeds have gone on for the best part of a month, and it suits everyone to bring them to a close. The announcement kills the perception, accurate or otherwise, that Bielsa could walk away. There is a buzz around him, and a buzz around Leeds. It has long been said that the Premier League will be better off with Leeds as one of its 20 clubs, but Bielsa's involvement gives the division an additional plot line. By chance, the fixture list for the 12th of September has created the ideal matchup on the opening weekend. Liverpool versus Leeds, Bielsa versus Jurgen Klopp, the Premier League champions versus the winners of the championship. Klopp is the polar opposite of Bielsa in some respects, outgoing, more playful with the media, and far less subdued. Almost hyperactive by comparison. The German has studied Leeds closely and warns his Liverpool squad that playing them will be uncomfortable. An end-to-end match with 7 goals in it does not contradict him. Leeds concede an early penalty, which Mo Salah converts, but Jack Harrison equalises soon after through a ploy he and Calvin Phillips have been working on all week. Phillips finds space in a deep area of his own half and hooks the ball down the left. As soon as possession reaches Phillips' feet, Harrison bursts forward, takes his pass and finishes sharply from the edge of Liverpool's box. Coffee sloshes out of Bielsa's cup as he jumps up and clenches his fists. The match rages back and forth, caution-free and full of adventure. But Liverpool win it 4-3 after Rodrigo, Leeds' record signing, trips Fabinho inside the box with 3 minutes to play. Salah scores from the penalty spot again. A point was in the offing, but Bielsa thinks Liverpool deserved the victory. On the whole, Liverpool were superior, he says. It's not the end of the world. Klopp looks pleased, if a little worn out by the mayhem, and Leeds' performance is widely acclaimed. They've taken on the best Liverpool team in three decades and ruffled their feathers in the most engaging contest of the first weekend. Match of the Day places it at the top of its schedule a few hours later. This, though, is how Leeds play and how they've always played under Bielsa. His message throughout the summer was simple. He will change nothing and sacrifice nothing by focusing on dominating possession and prepping his team to attack at will. It would be an error to think you should stop doing the things that made you successful, Bielsa says. The close season has been strange for Leeds and English football. COVID-19 is restricting everything, and having claimed the championship title in front of empty stadiums, there is no prospect of Leeds welcoming a crowd back to Elland Road soon. Bielsa's players took a fortnight's holiday at the end of the 2019-20 season, but have hardly stopped for 13 months. Even in the weeks of 2020 when football shut down and the Premier League and EFL suspended their schedules, Bielsa insisted on his squad training as vigorously as possible at home. Daily fitness routines and strict weight checks via WhatsApp. Leeds sent their players special scales and instructed them to submit photos of the readings every morning. We were lucky one week in lockdown when he gave us Sunday and Monday off, says right back Luke Ayling. In the main, there is precious little downtime with Bielsa. He has operated this way from the start, right back to his tenure as Newell's Old Boys manager in the 90s. In his first month of competitive matches as head coach at Leeds, the senior squad were given a single day off. Some changes have occurred in the backroom staff behind him. Carlos Corberan, the Spaniard who coached Leeds under-23s, has left to become manager of Huddersfield Town. Bielsa toys with the idea of using his Chilean assistant Diego Reyes to fill in as development squad boss, but changes his mind and promotes Mark Jackson from the under-18s instead. Diego Flores, another familiar face in Bielsa's dugout, chooses to leave and draw breath after 2 years at the coalface in Leeds. Flores doubled as Bielsa's media translator for a while, so Bielsa enlists Andres Clavillo, a Colombian analyst raised in South London, to take on that responsibility. The appearance of the young, fresh-faced Clavillo causes immediate fascination, and calls start arriving from journalists in Colombia trying to establish how it was that he became to be part of Bielsa's inner sanctum. In the transfer market, Leeds land two deals before the season starts. They pay £27 million to sign Rodrigo from Valencia, breaking the transfer record set at Elland Road by the £18 million purchase of Rio Ferdinand from West Ham United 20 years earlier. Rodrigo, a fully-fledged Spain international, is seen as such a key target that Bielsa calls him to discuss the move before it goes through. It is rare for Bielsa to reach out to prospective signings personally, but his overtures convince Rodrigo to join. Centre-back Robin Koch arrives from Freiburg for £13 million, replacing one of the shining lights of the 2019-2020 season, Ben White. Leeds have made attempts to convert Ben White's loan from Brighton into a permanent move, but failed with three offers, the highest worth £30 million with add-ons. White is off-limits, and Brighton refuse to buckle, so Leeds give up on him. Koch does not receive any contact from Bielsa himself, but in preparation for the transfer, Leeds sent him presentations, video footage and statistical analysis outlining the way Bielsa's side play. August is almost out, and neither Koch nor Rodrigo will have much time to get themselves up to speed before the Premier League gets underway. Bielsa has shown before that he gives no quarter to players who fall short of his physical demands or struggle to grasp the principles of his tactics. In the previous transfer window, Leeds took striker Jean-Kevin Augustin on loan from RB Leipzig with an obligation to sign him permanently for £18 million if they won promotion. Bielsa approved the transfer, but Augustin pulled a hamstring before long and played all of 49 minutes. As a result, Bielsa lost faith in him, and by the start of the 2020-21 season, Leeds are in dispute with Leipzig. The club have no desire to commit millions to a player Bielsa does not want, and whose deal in Germany is worth £90,000 a week. They hope to wriggle out of the transfer on the basis that the clause covering a full-time switch officially expired on 30th of June. COVID-19 delayed Leeds' promotion from the Championship until mid-July. Leipzig argue that in good faith, the 30th of June date should be taken to mean the end of the season, but neither side is willing to compromise. Augustin trains alone in France, estranged from both clubs, until he signs for Nantes as a free agent the day after the transfer window shuts in October. Leipzig submits a complaint to FIFA, asking the world governing body to arbitrate and award them compensation. Leeds signal their intention to fight the claim. On the pitch, Bielsa limits himself to a few warm-up games. He talks initially about arranging 6 or 7 friendlies, but he loses a clutch of players to international duty in the penultimate week of pre-season, including Calvin Phillips, who has been called up by England for the first time. Bielsa trims the schedule, and games against Fleetwood Town and Lincoln City are called off. He uses the spare time to put the remainder of his squad through his infamous murder ball sessions. The energy-sapping 11-versus-11 games are what underpin the fitness levels in Bielsa's dressing room, and Leeds' conditioning is exceptional. "The players just get fitter and fitter," says first-team sports scientist Tom Robinson. Over time, the body adapts. Bielsa flogs them relentlessly, but most are hardened to the routine by now. Liam Cooper, the club's captain, felt the difference when he began training before Bielsa's second season. "It's not that it's not hard," Cooper said, "but we know what to expect and we know what's coming. That makes it a bit easier." In the days before the season kicks off, broadcast journalists descend on Leeds' Thorpe Arch training ground. Phillips is interviewed by Soccer AM. Pablo Hernandez is chosen for international media duties. Bielsa does not involve himself in any of it, aside from his standard press conference. It's almost pointless trying to tempt him to do more. His appointment at Elland Road was big enough news for Amazon Prime to follow up its documentary on Manchester City by sending cameras to Leeds for a 6-part series covering Bielsa's first year as head coach. Regardless of Amazon's clout, there was no prospect at all of the producers being granted dressing room access. Bielsa was forever at a distance in the footage and did not speak to the camera directly until, in the last few days of filming, he bowed to repeated requests from chairman Andrea Rodriziani to conduct an interview. Rodriziani's money was funding the documentary and he wanted his head coach to speak. Bielsa did so under duress, allowing no questions and reviewing the season without interruption. He later claimed not to have watched the series, but officials at Leeds think that he did, and curiosity must have got the better of him. Despite the impression that he treats the media with indifference, Bielsa's staff translate English articles and cuttings about him every morning, helping him understand the tone of the coverage. As much as he follows his own mind resolutely, he likes to monitor the daily agenda. Leeds have been chasing Premier League football for 16 long years. This is what they crave for so long. But what will Bielsa make of the division, the most commercially powerful football league in the world? The glare of attention is on a different scale, and although Bielsa coped with intense scrutiny as Argentina's manager, that period of his career was one of the few that forced him to take a concerted break from the sport. He will tell you that his love of football is an amateur pleasure. In a highly professional industry, the roots of the game are what delight him most. Bielsa marks Phillips's England debut by giving him the shirt he wore as a defender with Newell's Old Boys in Argentina in the 1970s. It is handed over in a plain Nike shoebox and comes with 2 letters, one written by Bielsa in Spanish and the other a translation in English. In his comments, Bielsa applauds Phillips for acting with professionalism while playing with an amateur ethos. He said, "The Newell's shirt represented a time when people didn't play for money," says Phillips's mother, Lindsay Crosby. "It represented a time when people played football for feelings and for love. The Premier League is very different. The Premier League is a goldfish bowl where everything has a price." A few days after Bielsa signs his new contract at Leeds, the governing body strikes a revised broadcast deal in China worth hundreds of millions of pounds. Bielsa is sceptical about the creep of high-powered business in football. It has been growing for years, and Leeds, to an extent, are no different to any other major club. Rodriziani's multi-million pound fortune was amassed through the sale of TV sports rights and the creation of the company MP and Silver. In the Championship, Leeds were heavily reliant on his personal wealth. Speaking in 2018, Bielsa argued that commercial interests had changed football for the worse by placing too much emphasis on results. "It was hard to commit to a thrilling or risky style of play," he said, "because clubs will not thank you if results fail to match up. On the contrary, most will sack you. And because of this, the entertainment provided by football is destined to suffer as everyone fixates on the scoreline. The commercialization of football, when clubs are owned by private people, makes the result more important than anything," Bielsa said. "But the most attractive thing in football is the beauty of the game. Those who invest in football should be aware of that and take precautions to protect the business they bought." The fact that we are not taking care of the planet, our children will pay the consequences of our acts. And with football, it will be the same because we are destroying football. And in the future, we'll see the negative effects of this. Bielsa commanded large salaries in Europe, but to the naked eye, his lifestyle was austere. At the time when he made those comments, he was in the process of donating around £2 million to Newell's Old Boys for a new training facility in Rosario. His brother, Rafael, did the legal work on the project, and his sister, Maria Eugenia, produced the architectural designs. It was, in its entirety, an altruistic gesture, and back in England, his sparse lodgings in Wetherby were costing him little over £500 a month. Bielsa, in any case, will entertain as best he can. After narrowly losing one 7-goal game at Anfield, Leeds find themselves in the midst of another a week later in their first home game against Fulham at Elland Road. The stadium tells a story about how short the summer has been. Leeds have spent money renovating their media facilities, but new floodlights and improved dugouts, both required to meet Premier League standards, will have to wait. Time has run out, and Leeds ask for dispensation to delay the installation of floodlights while parts arrive from China. The club hoped to replace their fibre sand pitch too, but decided to hold that off for 12 months. A full reconstruction would take 14 weeks, and they have insufficient time. The surface at Elland Road will become a problem before long, but in early September, the sprinklers are on and the sun shines as Leeds and Fulham warm up. The clubs met here in June as both were edging their way towards promotion, Fulham via the playoffs. It was tight on that occasion until the second half, when Hernandez took control and Leeds carved out a healthy 3-0 win. This game looked like going the same way again. Leeds are 2-1 ahead at half-time, and Patrick Bamford and Helder Costa score early in the second half. Fulham look beaten, but Bielsa's players make the mistake of easing off. Fulham send on substitutes, and Bobby De Cordova-Reed and Alessandro Mitrovic bring the scoreline back to 4-3. The closing minutes are twitchy, but Leeds have a Premier League win on the board, their first of the season, and their first since 2004. Bielsa cuts a relaxed figure beforehand, picking out Fulham substitute Mario Lamina in the stands for a smile and a wave. They know each other from Bielsa's time as head coach of Marseille. But by injury time, he is marching around his technical area, barking at his team incessantly. The football has been worth every penny to watch, a delight for any neutral. But the part which satisfies Bielsa most is the last 10 minutes when Leeds reassert themselves in midfield and stifle Fulham's onslaught. He turns over a new leaf by fulfilling all of his required interviews afterwards. The data shows that over two matches, the established traits of Bielsa's team have flipped on their head. Their expected goal ratio is 1.67, but Leeds have scored 7. It goes against the narrative that followed Bielsa around through his two seasons in the Championship, that Leeds convert too few of their chances and make too little of their slick approach play. In their title-winning term, the club conceded 35 goals in 46 matches, but already they've shipped 7. "We are worried about that," Bielsa admits, and his staff will be busy clipping footage before the usual video analysis session on Monday morning. By the time Leeds go to Sheffield United the following Sunday, Bielsa has tightened them up at the back. They are more rigid at Bramall Lane, and, helped by a brilliant save from goalkeeper Ilan Melier in the first half, they establish proper control. Bielsa respects Chris Wilder, Sheffield United's coach, and is curious about aspects of Wilder's tactics, particularly the novel notion of overlapping centre-backs. He has never seen defenders used like that before, and while he and Wilder are at opposite ends of the personality spectrum, Wilder was known for being the life and soul of the party whenever the Yorkshire Press Corps threw their annual Christmas party. They are both mavericks in their own right. Rodrigo's introduction as a substitute gives Leeds more variation in the second half, and 2 minutes from time, Bamford runs onto Jack Harrison's cross and heads in the only goal. Wilder thinks Sheffield United were unlucky. Bielsa says the result is just, but later, after reviewing the match, he concedes that Wilder was right. "It's a refreshing change to hear a manager say that," Wilder remarks. "I've got an awful lot of respect for Marcelo." Leeds have 6 points from 3 games. Pep Guardiola and Manchester City are next. Not for the first time, Bielsa is making a splash. He and Leeds have found their feet in the Premier League and provided one of the more compelling stories of the opening month. In Argentina, viewing figures for Leeds' defeat at Liverpool exceeded expected numbers for Spain's El Clásico, the foreign fixture which invariably attracts the biggest television audience there. His previous jobs in management were relatively short because, it was said, his players ran out of steam eventually. Ricardo Lunari, a retired midfielder whom Bielsa coached at Newell's Old Boys, remembers the intensity of Bielsa's methods taking their toll. The wear and tear weakened the relationship, Lunari says. The players no longer wanted to deliver what Marcelo wanted, and when he realised that, the end of the cycle began. But the squad at Leeds are very much with him. Sheffield United away is his 104th game in charge, and none of the spark has gone. Leeds, at the outset, had no idea how long their relationship with Bielsa would last. They admired his brilliance, but they were alive to his singularity, the obsessive mind, and the uncompromising personality. In certain moments, he was a delight to be around. In others, he was aloof or difficult to please. In certain moments, Leeds would find that a phone call to tell Bielsa that Rodrigo was a done deal for £27 million ended with him asking pointed questions about why certain academy players that he wanted to keep were being offered out on loan. Life was never easy or at all predictable. And 48 hours before the opening fixture of the Premier League season, they would have a draft of his contract extension sat in front of them, still unsigned. That, in essence, was the nature of the marriage. Take Bielsa as he comes and trust in the best of him. Make him autonomous and make no attempt to restrain him. Paul Heckingbottom, Bielsa's predecessor, had asked for two additions to the coaching team when Leeds recruited him from Barnsley. As part of his own stipulations, Bielsa asked for eight. It was management on his terms, and the partnership Leeds were ready for when he stepped off the plane from Argentina with little more than the clothes on his back. Chapter 2. The Appointment. Aside from a few personal belongings, Marcelo Bielsa's luggage was filled with tracksuits. He had travelled light and was carrying the bare necessities when Leeds United collected him from the airport. What Bielsa needed for coaching was with him. Everything else he had left in Argentina, including his family. "He's a simple man," his brother Rafael told me. "He's complicated in the way he thinks, but very simple in the way he lives." In Argentina, they remember how Bielsa took himself off to a convent after exhausting himself as the country's national coach, a tired mind seeking a reclusive home. In England, he will gravitate towards a small flat in Wetherby, above the chiropodist surgery and across the road from a sweet shop. Leeds set him up at first with a room at Rudding Park, a four-star hotel near Harrogate. But Bielsa tired of the surroundings quickly. He was not minded to copy Jose Mourinho, who lived out of the Lowry Hotel in Salford, for the duration of his reign as Manchester United manager. Rudding Park was too plush and too far from Leeds' training ground. Bielsa wanted something modest, something relatively practical. In the months that follow, residents of Wetherby get used to regular sightings of him in the street, backpack on, head down, and earphones in, as he walks in the fresh air. Bielsa liked tango music and Argentinian folk songs in his younger years. He would spend hours listening to lectures on politics and philosophy, given by people whose ideas or opinions interested him. More often than not, he would be dressed in Leeds United training gear, his initials on the right side of his chest. Training gear was his usual attire. At the club's centenary dinner in 2019, Bielsa turned up in a tracksuit and white trainers, the sore thumb in a room full of tuxedos. Photos of him appeared in the national press the next day, and after seeing them, he wrote to the board at Elland Road, apologising for any offence he had caused. Leeds laughed the letter off, tickled by the notion of Bielsa upsetting them. By then, they were well acquainted with his mannerisms. It was training gear for Bielsa when Leeds unveiled him as their new head coach at a busy press conference. On the 25th of June 2018, day one of the revolution, and ground zero for a club who wanted to extinguish their recent unproductive history. Leeds had been negotiating with him for more than 2 months, and he was in the building at last, sporting an oversized grey T-shirt and carrying a briefcase packed with notes. His media briefing took place on the fourth floor of Elland Road's East Stand, a level of the stadium which had seen much in its time. It was in the same room that Massimo Cellino, unusually relaxed with sunglasses hanging from his collar, announced the sale of Leeds to a suited and booted Andrea Ridriziani in 2017, one Italian businessman selling to another. It was on this floor, a little further down the hall, where Cellino introduced David Hockaday, back in work after his sacking by Forest Green Rovers, as Leeds' new head coach in 2014. Cellino and Hockaday walked out of the upstairs lift and turned right. Bielsa stepped out and turned left, taking everyone in the opposite direction, metaphorically and physically. Neither appointment was quite believable, but Bielsa's was outlandish for the right reasons, an elite coach taking on English football's impossible job. Leeds' first phone call to him was made as the 2017-18 Championship season drew to a close. A manager was in place at Elland Road, Yorkshireman Paul Heckingbottom, but confidence in him had dried up after only 4 months. Heckingbottom hung around after the season finished in May, taking a young squad on a post-season tour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.